So PechaKuchas, why does Sozosei use PechaKucha as a format? We use it because we believe that it gives folks an opportunity to bring their most creative selves to their work and how they tell their stories. PechaKucha is a 20-slide, 20-second per side presentation, and notably those slides are visual only. We have in this case broken the rules only in one way, which is that the last slide contains information about the presenters and their organization. We felt that that was a fair and equitable breaking of the rules. If not, we can discuss that privately at dinner. In addition, the PechaKucha presenters are all listed in your program. So if you'd like some more information, you'll see them there. After we see the PechaKucha presenters, which are going to begin with the Confess Project, Lorenzo Lewis is beside me. He's gonna take over once I depart the stage. After everyone has presented, I'm gonna call up Dan Gorenstein, who, as I hope you all know, is the wonderful host of the podcast Tradeoffs about healthcare policy, and Dan will be leading us through questions and answers. So with that, I will step away and turn it over to you, Lorenzo. Welcome.
A mother's greatest moment when bringing a child into this world is celebrating it with family and friends. Well, unfortunately, my mother was unafforded to have that opportunity because here she was, incarcerated in Newark, New Jersey. Yes, I was the child being born in a prison. This child would obviously grow and would begin to go through a lot of childhood trauma, all the way up to enough being able to go into a behavioral health facility at the age of 10. Behavior all over the place, misunderstood, going through a lot of trials and tribulations that I faced in my early years really led me on a very poor trajectory. I felt misunderstood. I felt like I was alone. And the truth be told, I felt like life had really given me a bad card to deal with. I felt like I was defeated. And in fact, I hadn't been given a fair shot like my other peers and classmates who was not born into prison to an incarcerated mother. I can remember being in this facility, feeling heartbroken, taken away from my family, and recognizing that I wasn't so normal like everybody else. That there was a reason that I came into this facility to get just a little bit more support and help that I needed. And I never forget being at the facility, getting that phone call. My father had passed away. And it felt like the world was crumbling down on me. As not living with my mother and father, staying with my aunt and uncle, who had stepped in before social services could take charge. Losing now one of my parents, someone that I really wouldn't get to know as well, was taken away from me at a very early age. This grief would do a tremendous impact on the psychological impact of myself to others, my behaviors again, the way that I interacted with others, weight gain, the list goes on and on. Adverse childhood experiences had really, really taken my soul at such an early age. But I got lucky enough that during this facility time that I was serving, getting the treatment that I needed, I met a really cool mentor by the name of Mr. Jesse. You know, Mr. Jesse was very unique. He had a way of really, really talking with people. He really helped me out. I really trusted Mr. Jesse. Fast forward in life, I'm let out. I enter gang activities, skipping of school, trying different drugs. The list goes on and on. And here I was, one moment away from being charged as a felony in my senior year in high school for a firearm. And recognizing that that in this place, it really reminded me of something. Like it felt very familiar and I almost felt like I was at home. But in fact, I wasn't. It's where I was born at. So it felt like it all came together. So I fell into a deeper depression. And I felt like I didn't want to go further. That life had really, at this point, cut me off. And that I probably would die here. And I remember the judge giving me a second chance, saying that, Mr. Lewis, I believe that you can do it. But I don't want to see you back in my courtroom. And that if I do, I will assure you that you'll do the most adult time that's possible. Because I know who you run with. I know the neighborhood you live in. And I know it's very optimal for you to do this again. And going through this period of time, I told the judge that I would like another chance. That experience led me to going to college and going to work in behavioral health, getting my first job, working with other young men that looked like me, recognizing that there was such a gap and there was such a huge need for addressing the mental health of young black men in America. And I knew that I can do something about it. I knew that my prior experiences really truly gave me a seat at changing this trajectory. Regardless of my background, regardless if I didn't want to become a physician or not, that I had went through recovery and that I know I can help solve this problem. Fast forward, 2016, the Confess Project was born. It's a national grassroots initiative that focused on training black barbers across America to be mental health advocates. We train these barbers by active listening, empathy, compassion, training them on working with over 100 clients per month that each barber can see and changing their lives. Untapped potential, everyday people that's on the front lines of changing the mental health care system. These barbers are very impactful. They have a true and definitive way of speaking with someone weekly. As a matter of fact, there's more than just talking about politics, relationships. They often talk about how the Dallas Cowboys lost this past Sunday. Barbershop talk, what do we call it? It's a safe place, a place for communities, and a place where people come to really heal and truly thrive. 90% of our barbers stated that they'd rather receive mental health care and treatment inside of a barbershop rather than going to a behavioral health facility. And in fact, 50% of them are more inclined about mental health education than they were before. We had a barber here in Philadelphia that had a client sit in his chair and told him he wanted to kill himself. Do you know how that would make you feel if someone told you that? But on the other hand, we had another barber in Memphis, Tennessee that had a client to do the same exact thing. Thank God he went through our training. He was able to get that client to resources and support and perform the crisis intervention that we teach and was able to help their client save his life. We've partnered with Harvard University. In a long eight-month study, Harvard has interviewed our barbers in recognizing that not only they are change agents, but they truly are suicide prevention gatekeepers in the black community. That they can also be a part of solving crimes and violence as well, because of their reach with people that's very hard to reach that the system can't get to. The Confess Project has now trained to over 1,000 barbers by the end of this month in 40 cities. I'm an Echo and Green Fellow. I'm a Roddenberry Fellow. We've also partnered with foundations such as Gillette, Snapchat, family foundations from Atlanta and all across the United States. We've been named one of the number 7 health companies by Fast Company for our most innovative intervention that we have in barbershops. The Confess Project reimagined looking at young men that had a Mr. Jesse, recognizing that those relationships was very pivotal. And those relationships were also pivotal when I used to go to my aunt's beauty salon as a kid. And recognizing that this all connects, that we can truly solve a greater issue and a greater problem. Will you join us? Thank you.
Thank you so much, Lorenzo. Wow. All right. Hi, everyone. My name is Matt Goldman. I'm the Medical Director for Crisis Services for the San Francisco Department of Public Health. And I'm going to be talking to you about expanding the evidence for crisis services, a path forward. The path of being in a mental health crisis is a long and a windy one, and it's up to us to make sure people in crisis get the highest quality care possible. I was a psychiatry resident when I first worked on a mobile crisis team, and I so vividly remember visiting a patient in suicidal crisis, who here we can call Frank. It was so powerful to meet Frank where he was at, in his home, on his terms, surrounded by photos of his loved ones. This is so different from the fluorescent lit hospital rooms that I was used to working in, and I wondered constantly, why don't we do more of this? And what are the best practices that I should follow when I'm caring for someone like Frank? These are complex questions, and it turns out we don't have many easy answers. If Frank were to have called the National Suicide Prevention Lifeline, which will become 988, we know that hotline counseling has a strong research base to guide the de-escalation and suicide prevention interventions that can best keep him safe. But what if Frank was calling because he had just relapsed on heroin, or because he was hearing voices, or was in some other type of mental health crisis, the worst day of his life? We do not yet have research to support best practices in those scenarios. If Frank was in a crisis that required an in-person assessment, research studies have told us that a mobile crisis team would be more likely to help him avoid going into the hospital than if he were to go to the emergency department, and he'd be less likely to be arrested than if law enforcement had responded to see him. But what's the optimal configuration for mobile crisis teams in terms of co-responder models, involuntary versus voluntary treatment, clinical pathways for various presentations and populations? So far, these studies have not been done. If Frank needed additional support in a crisis facility, we know that crisis residential treatment has better client satisfaction and lower costs than inpatient treatment. But how effective are peer support models compared to medical models? What are optimal lengths of stay to help resolve most crises, rather than being constrained by an arbitrary 23-hour limit set by regulators and payers? And what about cross-cutting questions like best practices for providing follow-up care post-crisis? How should services be adapted in urban versus rural settings? Which practices are most likely to divert people in crisis from getting arrested and put in jail? And do these services actually reduce disparities and advance equity in access to mental health care? Rarely have these questions been studied, perhaps due to stigma or lack of services research funding, or because these questions are complex and there are no easy answers. But we need research to support crisis program design as well as clinical best practices. It would never fly to allow emergency interventions for heart attacks based solely on anecdotal evidence. We owe it to our vulnerable patients like Frank to make sure that we're serving them in the best way possible. So where do we go from here? The implementation of 988 and the groundswell of investment in crisis services means there are countless new programs that can be studied to expand the evidence base. This is a once-in-a-generation opportunity, but this work won't happen on its own. It will require an organized national effort to move us down the right path. I believe there are five key strategies to make this happen. Develop a crisis research agenda, align quality improvement and research activities, build data infrastructure, improve data collection on race and ethnicity, and foster a community of crisis data experts. So first, a research agenda. As I've described, there are so many gaps in the evidence base for crisis services. Programs across the crisis continuum all need additional research on clinical best practices, as well as guidance on ideal models at the program and service system level. So there's a need for subject matter experts in behavioral health, emergency medical services, criminal justice reform, social determinants of health, and other ally fields to convene and develop a crisis services research agenda to guide the field and include direct input from people with lived experience of mental health crisis. Second, align quality in research. Local health officials and academics often work in silos. I have known more than one administrator who instantly fell asleep upon hearing the word research. But quality metrics and implementation science outcomes are more alike than they are different. We don't only need randomized control trials. There is a need for consensus around quality metrics and benchmarks, and research can help. Community-based participatory research can inform science and services alike. Patients, payers, and policymakers all stand to benefit from advances in crisis services research. Third, data infrastructure. Relevant information exists in many types of databases. We've got clinical electronic health records, ambulance run logs, police reports, insurance claims, death records, and many more. But linkages between these data rarely exist in the ways that are needed to support robust quality improvement and more rigorous research. So there's a need for investment of resources and analyst expertise to develop data infrastructure that can be used in both quality and research activities. For this to be possible, we must advocate for smart and sustainable approaches to reporting and evaluation requirements in federal and state legislation and funding initiatives. Fourth, data on race and ethnicity. Incomplete ethno-racial data makes it impossible to conduct equity studies. What disparities need to be addressed by a crisis system? Does implementing crisis services perpetuate, worsen, or dismantle structural racism and entrenched inequities? Without race and ethnicity data, we'll never know. So to improve this kind of data, evaluators can provide specialized training to clinical staff on how to collect sociodemographic data, which may be understandably challenging in the midst of a crisis. Linking clinical records to other databases with more robust race and ethnicity data is another strategy. Fifth and finally, foster a community of crisis data experts. Although this work has been challenging to advance for all the reasons I've described so far, some researchers, some of whom are sitting in this room, and quality experts have been doing this for years and have many lessons learned to share with colleagues in the field. There is a need for a network of experts to share best practices for implementation science methods to study these real-world models, promote research funding opportunities like grants and RFPs, requests for proposals, disseminate crisis research articles and presentations, and advocate for funding to support this work. Five strategies to advance crisis research and evaluation: develop a crisis research agenda, align quality and research, build data infrastructure, improve race and ethnicity data, and foster a community of crisis data experts. These are starting points to expand the evidence base for crisis call centers, mobile teams, crisis facilities, and post-crisis follow-up. We can do this together. Someday, we'll rest easier knowing that Frank is getting the best care possible at every turn. Thank you.
Thank you for your work. So this is a photo of my family. And I know you can't tell from this photo, but both my parents are deaf, and we use American Sign Language, or we text each other to communicate. A few years ago, when my father was home alone, his gallbladder ruptured. As a deaf man, he was not able to call 911 for help. He texted me to call 911 for him, but I was not near my phone at that time. As his daughter, this really affected me. Why couldn't my dad text 911 directly? 70% of 911 call centers can't receive texts, but there are 37 million Americans, like my parents, who can't call 911. Due to aging legacy tech, the soonest the United States would get 100% access is in 2030. That's too long to wait. Our 911 system is broken and antiquated. You're given priority if you can speak fluent English, if you can hear the dispatcher, and if you sound like they do. Large 911 corporations make it so expensive to upgrade systems and give access to the highest payer. People with privilege don't see our problems. So many communities are left out. People with disabilities aren't the only ones that lack access. Think of all the people: non-English speakers, domestic violence survivors, They're left out of this voice-centric system. And that's why we founded AccesSOS. Using the best solutions, we built a free mobile web app. It's an accessible user interface, and in three clicks, you can quickly contact your local 911 call center. Our soft launch is live in New Mexico right now. Currently, AccesSOS is designed for three types of emergency services: medical, police, and fire. But when we listen to our community members who don't communicate in English, or hear when an armed police officer speaks out loud to them, the theme is they're scared to use our app to contact police. We asked a deaf Black man, what would you do if the police didn't know you couldn't hear? He didn't know. He pointed to his ears and signed, "I hope that never happens." We see opportunity to build 988 differently, to represent the diversity, the mental health needs, and technology of today's society. We are shaping the future of access to emergency services, and this is where V comes in to our story. A disabled graduate student herself, she has helped us reimagine inclusive design.
Imagine having a mental health emergency, or having autism, or any combination of identities that isn't seen by the police. How do you get the right kind of help, especially if you're considered a threat? Imagine being handcuffed, but your only way of communicating is through your hands. There are too many heartbreaking stories of deaf individuals incarcerated, assaulted, or killed because they were seen as being uncooperative with the police, but they simply couldn't hear. It's moments like this that tell us our communities need more relevant support than law enforcement. We are adding a fourth option for emergency services that includes mental health and other community needs that right now, data is not collected about. The only publicly available, nationally organized data that we have doesn't specify behavioral health needs. By adding a fourth option for emergency services to our app interface, we will provide data-driven momentum towards building more relevant emergency services nationwide. We strive to provide the same type of access that others can assume through calling 911. No fees, no registration, while also considering their identities to get them the right kind of help. So far, we have learned many things, but the pieces of information I'll share with you today that can divert calls from 911 to local crisis centers instead. Whether it is a violent situation or not, the mental and physical health status and history of the person to be treated, and whether any substances are involved. Communities that are marginalized are understandably often more likely to experience mental health emergencies, which is why our app tells those who respond to emergencies about important identity factors like autism, like mental health needs, so responders don't further perpetuate systemic issues. Communities that experience mental health emergencies often don't know about the services that are available to them. We can streamline the process, minimizing the need for them to already know who to contact. We are also learning what different words for the fourth option will include might look like to different people, like social services versus crisis intervention versus mental health. But even though we can make communication more accessible, we're just the messengers. Crisis situations happen all the time. In fact, they happen more often during non-business hours. So having mobile crisis response teams for limited hours isn't enough. AccesSOS provides communication by converting a message, kind of like a Google form, into a voice message that plays on repeat for a 911 dispatcher. Currently, we are learning how to translate information in a way that helps humanize the person in need for the 911 dispatcher. So what can you do? Tell people who we are. Our cause can be difficult to wrap your head around, especially if you've never heard of these issues. And awareness is the first step towards meaningful change. We look forward to answering any questions you have during the Q&A. I'm V, a UC Berkeley graduate student and head of product at AccesSOS.
And I'm Gabriella, the founder of and CEO of AccesSOS. And we believe accessibility is a human right. Thank you for your time.
Good afternoon, everyone. My name is Barbara Marsh, and I'm the Chief Operating Officer at OneFifteen. Unintentional drug overdoses have devastated the lives of American citizens. And in the last 10 years, over 800,000 individuals have lost their lives due to a drug overdose. In 2020, more people died of a drug overdose than any other one-year period in our history. The drug epidemic still remains a major public health emergency. One community that has been drastically impacted by the drug epidemic is Dayton, Ohio. It is where I live, where I work, and where I play. Dayton is a Midwestern city like many others. And in 2017, the national media named Dayton ground zero for the drug epidemic. Hundreds of individuals lost their lives. Families were devastated, and my strong community was brought to its knees. Our county jail was also bursting at the seams, as it became the largest detox center in our area. People needed immediate treatment, not incarceration. So out of the ashes of the drug epidemic rose the idea of OneFifteen. OneFifteen was named to honor the 115 people that die each day of opioid overdoses in the United States. And this number still continues to rise. To address the gap in treatment services in Dayton, we began to ask the questions. What if we could create an ecosystem that offers a full continuum of care of services? What if we could meet people where they are? What if? OneFifteen began a quest to reverse the course of addiction treatment. In October of 2019, our outpatient clinic was opened. In February 2020, the doors of the OneFifteen Crisis Stabilization Unit opened. It was the first of its kind in Ohio. Any person who was in active addiction could immediately access treatment 24 hours a day, 7 days per week. And no one is ever turned away. People are now diverted from emergency departments, and law enforcement bring people directly to our crisis stabilization unit rather than the county jail. The crisis stabilization unit is the beginning of the OneFifteen continuum of care designed to stabilize individuals in a supportive and respectful environment. In March of 2020, OneFifteen opened its inpatient residential unit. And in June of 2021, a longer stay non-medical residential unit was added. The full continuum of care is now available on our campus, and over 4,000 people have found hope and healing at OneFifteen in just 2 years. We have a campus that looks more like a college rather than an addiction treatment center. We want our patients to feel honored and welcome. By providing a full continuum of care under one organization, OneFifteen delivers seamless transition from one level of care to the next without a break in treatment. This can absolutely be the difference between life or death for someone experiencing addiction. When the COVID-19 pandemic spread across the world, we knew we had to find a way to reach our patients virtually. The good news is Vera Lee is a founding partner of OneFifteen, and the team of software engineers at Vera Lee developed a telehealth platform almost overnight, which allowed us to connect to our patients while stay-at-home orders were still in place. Since the platform was launched, we have provided over 10,000 telehealth visits to our patients. The telehealth platform has now been replaced with a more robust clinician platform. The clinician platform allows patients and clinicians to track progress, manage appointments, and reach out for help when they need it most. These tools are essential to our patient care. So what now? We know that criminalizations of those who experience mental illness and the disease of addiction remains a major concern in our country. In 2019, Ohio passed the Good Samaritan Law, and this law allows a person to petition the court to dismiss drug charges if a person receives a diagnostic assessment. With the support of the Sozosei Foundation, OneFifteen is harnessing technology and will embed telehealth services within our criminal justice system to support immediate access to needed assessment services. And we will continue to advocate for the decriminalization of those who experience the disease of addiction and mental illness. We have already integrated telehubs in our public defender's office, and we will also place telehubs in our courtrooms and our correctional institutions. We have placed telehubs in our hospital systems, and in 2022, we will be partnering with federally qualified health centers in rural Ohio to place telehubs in these locations. So what have we learned? We have been able to show that our patients who engage in telehealth services are more likely to remain engaged in care and less likely to drop out of treatment. We know that one size does not fit all, and that's why we believe in a high-tech, high-touch approach to care. By offering both in-person and virtual care options, patients can choose their path towards recovery. By offering a full continuum of care and a hybrid model of service delivery, we will show a decrease in hospitalizations, decrease in criminal justice involvement, decrease in overdose deaths, but we will ultimately increase the quality of life for those in my community. We refuse to allow Dayton to be defined as ground zero for the drug epidemic. While we continue to honor those who have lost their lives, we also celebrate those who have recovered from addiction and mental illness. And our community is now a community of hope, not of devastation. 115's mission is to heal people through learning, science, and partnership. So let us find ways that we can work together to reverse the course and make a difference in your community as well. Thank you.
Hi, everybody. Post-traumatic prison disorder. My name is Shawanna Vaughn, and I'm the director of Silent Cry. Thank you to the Sosa Foundation. Post-traumatic prison disorder, Shawanna W76337. My name is Shawanna Vaughn, and on April the 15th, 1978, Joyce Vaughn, shackled in chains, spread legs with iron, wrist and legs would bear life in these conditions, push under pain in captivity to birth the dream and the hope of a slave in a California prison plantation. Children of incarceration begin their lives in trauma and out of the womb into their ACEs. ACEs are childhood adverse experiences of sexual molestation, alienation of affections, depression, etc. I am post-traumatic prison disorder, Shawanna W76337, which means I am the intersection between the ACEs and mass incarceration. Black women and girls are disproportionately incarcerated and experience greater health outcomes compared to our counterparts. 46% of women incarcerated suffer from mental health issues, and 31% of men suffer from mental health issues as well. Post-traumatic prison disorder exacerbates by solitary confinement, prison rape, dehumanization, and a culture of perpetual violence, and no services to address mental health. Big Pharma and the prison industry are colluding to over-medicate the incarcerated population. Medication is used as a tool of maintenance in a prison environment. I was given Elavil to wake up and Ritalin to go to sleep. And I said, I knew this was wrong. And it's a defiance not to take pills. They put you in solitary confinement. And you have to have a lawyer not to take medication. Well, who knows, you have to do all these steps. Depression, anxiety, bipolarism, schizophrenia, personality disorder, etc. All the things that prison causes, trauma. Mental health has no border, it doesn't discriminate, it has no economic standing, but post-traumatic prison disorder does. Prison birth and sterilization are forms of trauma that we aim to address in legislation. By giving women mental health trauma providers, social workers to maintain their links to their children and maintaining bonds. 18 women per thousand commit suicide alone in a Texas prison. Suicide is one of the leading causes of death in the U.S. prisons. It exceeds those of the general population. Don't forget, Khalif Browder is an American example of post-traumatic prison disorder in the intersection of lack of mental health services and the effects of suicide, not to mention his innocence. For Quentin Jones, Nakima Hill, and Leroy Washington, I ask in legislation for guards to be mandated to therapy to reduce harm. 14 days into incarceration, while an individual is detained and evaluated by an informed trauma therapist. Hear their silent cries. Advocacy and legislation must happen together. I urge you to stand with me. I am calling on legislators around the country to adopt post-traumatic prison disorder. Let's change the laws. Add to the DSM-5 and create solutions for healing. We release and reincarcerate mental illness at 18% higher than anyone. We have no mental health hospitals for people who suffer from ACEs and just life experiences. If your body is locked up, your mind deserves to be free. We value dogs and cats at the Humane Society over people incarcerated who suffer in silence. For every mental health professional, lawmaker, and influencer, foundation who champions change in mental health, I urge you to champion post-traumatic prison disorder, Shawanna W76337. It's the only mass incarceration mental health bill. And I understand that legislation has to be written for us by us. So I wrote legislation, just like my birth, in public housing, which is an atrocity, in my kitchen, with help of my friends, because legislation has to look for us, by us. And if that's not your trauma, that you don't have a solution. So I urge everybody who is aiming for mental health solutions, who believe in advocacy and legislation, to grab hold to post-traumatic prison disorder and create legislation in your states that has longstanding holds for people like me, because we have faces and we have names. I have four siblings, and three of us have been incarcerated. We hand down legacy trauma, but there's a solution. I've heard everybody give out resources, but now I'm urging you to allow me to drive you to champion post-traumatic prison disorder, Shawanna W76337. Thank you.
Good afternoon. My name is Jeremy Spiegel. I'm the consulting attorney with the Camden Medical Legal Partnership, which is a partnership between the Camden Coalition of Healthcare Providers and the Rutgers Law School.
And I'm Ashley Maddison. I'm also an attorney. And last month, I completed a two-year Equal Justice Works Fellowship at the Camden Medical Legal Partnership, or MLP.
The Camden Coalition is a community-based nonprofit working to improve care for people with complex health and social needs in Camden, New Jersey, and across the country. We develop care management models with the goal of achieving person-centered, equitable care. Today, we'll focus on our MLP program and lessons we have learned through our legal work.
The Camden Coalition developed the practice of healthcare hotspotting to identify individuals with complex needs by utilizing our Health Information Exchange, which collects secure medical information from the region. Over time, we narrowed our focus to the small population that we were seeing cycle in and out of emergency departments and hospital inpatient units.
Our Camden Care Management model utilizes a team of nurses, social workers, and community health workers to help patients meet their goals. Our objective is to empower patients with the skills and support they need to avoid preventable hospital use and improve their well-being. We engage and enroll patients at the hospital bedside, in the community, and telephonically.
Over time, we realized that while reconnecting individuals to the same healthcare systems might help temporarily, that wasn't addressing the structural problems that we were seeing. For example, coordinating care for unhoused people did not help in the long term if they still did not have a home. In response, in 2015, we launched a permanent supportive housing program for people experiencing chronic homelessness.
Similarly, our care teams recognized that participants faced unmet legal needs, exacerbating the health problems. Our 2016 patient survey found that the vast majority of coalition patients had legal concerns, including accessing government benefits and obtaining and retaining housing. Meanwhile, very few patients could find legal support.
So in 2017, we launched a medical legal partnership between the Camden Coalition and Rutgers Law School to integrate attorneys into coalition care teams. Consulting lawyers work with care teams to evaluate the potential patient legal issues. And in many cases, a lawyer joins the care team to meet a patient and determine the scope of MLP engagement.
Our MLP is unique in several respects. We are integrated with care coordination teams, not physicians. So we are providing legal services as part of a whole person, patient-centered approach. Care teams have great insight into patients because they work with individuals in their homes and in the community. This also engenders a greater degree of trust, enabling us to provide better legal support.
We also benefit from the Camden Coalition's access to medical records and use of data. For example, we're better advocates because we have a complete picture of a patient's history and the ability to reference and access medical records. This MLP within a complex care model is a powerful tool for all patients, and especially patients facing mental health challenges.
90% of patients in Camden Coalition core interventions were diagnosed with a psychiatric and/or substance use disorder. 100% of patients in our supportive housing program have a behavioral health diagnosis. Many of our patients have relied heavily on crisis care services.
Based on our experience serving over 200 individuals these past 4 years, we feel strongly that the MLP, or medical legal partnership model, is an underutilized and underfunded asset for decriminalizing mental health and an essential component of complete crisis care response. Legal issues exacerbate mental health issues, and legal supports should be part of that answer.
When we launched our MLP, we quickly identified an area of need not reflected on the patient survey. Many patients, and particularly patients facing mental health issues, had unresolved engagement with the New Jersey municipal court system. That's the low-level criminal court system in the state. This often included open warrants for failing to appear or failing to pay court-imposed penalties.
40 of the individuals we've served have required this type of legal support for lingering matters involving charges like shoplifting, loitering, and yes, even jaywalking. This has brought us into the municipal courts and pushed us to take a hard look at the systemic forces causing so many patients to face such extended entanglements with the justice system.
We see that police engagement, prosecution, fines, and judicial condemnation, these are not the answers for our patients. Court appearances, warrants, and especially incarceration, exacerbate mental health conditions and make future justice involvement more likely.
We need a paradigm shift at the local level, among police, judges, and elected leaders. Less focus on citations and revenue and punishment, more emphasis on identifying mental health concerns and treatment. The MLP model and an enhanced crisis care continuum should play a role in this shift.
One patient story provides a stark illustration. Tom was jailed 5 times the year before our care team met him. Each instance was related to chronic mental health issues and poverty. A store manager would call 911, police would arrest Tom and send him to jail, where he would remain for a few days, breaking any hope of consistent treatment, only to be let out onto the street with nothing. And this cycle would repeat.
With the benefit of our care team and the MLP, Tom moved from crisis to stability, from prosecution toward empowerment. We located stable housing, connected Tom to services, worked on legal matters causing Tom anxiety and frustration, and provided him a patient ID card that helped him to self-advocate to law enforcement and crisis response teams.
Repeat calls to 911 and police involvement with Tom were counterproductive, as is the case for so many other patients that we have all served. A functional 988 system informed by the participants at this summit, fully integrated into an ecosystem of care providers and care navigators, can be a part of the solution.
As we move in that direction, we encourage everyone to broaden your conception of the crisis care continuum to include the medical-legal partnership model. Connecting patients with legal services, especially when integrated with healthcare coordination and other medical and social supports, can increase stability and reduce future justice involvement.
We want to conclude with a look to the future. In January, we will expand our efforts with a legal fellow dedicated to supporting Cooper Hospital's addiction medicine program. We expect this will be another powerful demonstration of how the impact a medical legal partnership can have for patients with mental health issues. And we look forward to sharing our data and findings with all of you as we work together towards decriminalizing mental illness. Thank you.
Thank you.
Hi, my name is Zee Sun. I'm a psychiatrist from New York and co-founder of Affect Mental Health. I'd like you to meet Montez. She's a proud mother of 2 and grandmother of 5. She works at the food bank and lives in her own apartment where she loves to play Jenga with her grandkids. And her guilty pleasure is Taco Bell. If you met Montez, you would not know that she's in recovery from schizophrenia and cocaine addiction, and that she's been the subject of over 100 911 calls, and that she's been hospitalized for over 200 days in a locked psychiatric unit, and that because of her untreated mental illness, she was previously homeless and jailed several times for violent behavior. Unfortunately, what Montez had to go through is common for people in our communities with severe mental illness. My patients, like Montez, would go missing. And when I found out that they were inappropriately trapped in jails and prisons, I felt a deep injustice. Like many of us today, I turned my anger into action. I now work to break this terrible cycle of people alternating between homelessness, hospitals, and jails. We all know someone with a journey similar to Montez, whether it's a client you provide services for, or maybe a family member. A root cause of this cycling is that the healthcare, housing, and criminal justice systems are siloed. At Affect Mental Health, we are solving the multiple system failures, much like we discussed today, that trap people in this vicious cycle. We're building a world where severe mental illness is not a diagnosis of doom, as Kara so eloquently shared yesterday, but a world where people can thrive and flourish, just like Montez is doing now. We take a two-pronged approach. At the client level, we provide coaching to service providers on evidence-based practices. And at the systems level, we facilitate contract negotiations to integrate the health, housing, and justice systems to prevent people from getting into the criminal justice system. Here's why both coaching and contracting are important. We know that best practices work, but implementation is challenging. So we provide high-touch coaching on evidence-based practices supported by data-driven population health management. Innovative contracts between service providers and payers, such as local health plans, local governments, enable financially sustainable collaboration across the health, housing, and criminal justice systems. Everything we do is designed to improve outcomes and generate cost savings so that infrastructure we build in each community is self-sustaining. Now, let me tell you about a few of the best practices we enhance with our coaching. Assertive Community Treatment, or ACT, is a life-changing care model for people with severe mental illness and the highest needs. ACT involves a psychiatrist, peers with lived experience, therapists and addiction counselors, housing and vocational specialists who all help clients stay out of the hospital and achieve housing stability and employment. And all of these specialists deliver their services in the community where clients are. My mentors at University of Rochester developed an adaptation of ACT that decriminalizes mental illness called Forensic ACT. By working with drug and mental health court judges, probation and parole officers, Forensic ACT cuts recidivism by half and reduces hospital days fivefold. And this training has been delivered in over 65 counties across 7 states. The majority of ACT clients are homeless. So we bring together ACT teams with Housing First, which is also a national best practice. The guiding principle is, as soon as you say yes to housing, your life changes. Housing First is designed to meet clients where they are, whether or not they want treatment or are still using substances. And with continued engagement from ACT teams, 85% of clients remain stably housed after a full year. So by supercharging the hundreds of ACT teams across the country with Forensic ACT training and connecting our clients to Housing First, we enable people with severe mental illness to thrive. Now you may be thinking, these comprehensive services sound really expensive. Well, in the US, we are already spending $38 billion in healthcare for people with severe mental illness. A lot of this spending is from avoidable emergency room visits and hospitalizations. So when our coaching prevents these expensive hospital visits, we're able to reinvest these dollars into housing and data-driven collaboration to keep people out of the criminal justice system. We know that when Forensic ACT and Housing First are delivered with high fidelity through coaching, they improve outcomes and reduce costs. Each ACT team serves about 100 clients and can save $1 million in healthcare costs every year. To reinvest these savings from avoided hospital visits, reduced bookings, and days in jails or prison, we use shared savings and value-based contracts, social impact bonds, and performance-based contracts. These contracts amplify existing funding sources. ACT is already Medicaid reimbursed in over 40 states, and Congress has deemed Housing First as the solution to homelessness, opening the door to local and federal dollars for supportive housing. To secure this sustainable financing, we've partnered with Corporation for Supportive Housing. They have a tried and true approach, securing over $1 billion for supportive housing models, including ACT and Housing First for justice-involved individuals across the country. With performance-based contracts in place, we need to deliver better outcomes and reduce costs from expensive hospitalizations and criminal justice system utilization. So this is why coaching is so important. And we all get better at what we do when we have coaching. It's the coaching that generates the improved outcomes and shared savings that drives financial sustainability. And we all learn just as much from our colleagues as we do from our coaches. So we have virtual learning communities across multiple states to share lessons learned. And finally, to improve outcomes and reduce costs, we facilitate data-driven population health, integrating data across the three silos of healthcare, housing, and criminal justice. For example, we take statewide data from the Health Information Exchange and integrate it with the Homeless Management Information System and real-time jail stay and booking data. And it's our coaching that makes all of this data actionable at point of care. Our team of coaches and contracting experts is the glue that brings together the health, housing, and criminal justice systems. What makes our approach unique is a relentless, data-driven focus on financial sustainability. Together, I look forward to co-creating a future where people like Montez, with severe mental illness who are inappropriately criminalized, can thrive and flourish. We're currently active in these states and looking for more partners. So if you're interested, please email me, and I look forward to collaborating. Thank you.
Last one, y'all. Good afternoon. My name is Bill Smith, founder of Inseparable. Before I begin, I want to let you know I'm going to be talking about depression, suicide, and the criminalization of mental illness. If I could leave you with just one thought today, it would be this. Nobody's worst day should take away their chance to live their best life. This is a picture of my brother Jack and me when we were kids. On the left, he's rocking the bowl cut and the fashion-forward denim outfit. I'm the one with the curly hair and white shoes. In the second picture, we're reading the Eufaula Tribune, the small-town Alabama weekly newspaper that our parents ran, where Jack would one day become the editor and publisher. Jack was a great big brother and a great journalist. He loved telling people stories and always managed to bring out the best in people through his writing. For years, though, Jack battled depression and anxiety. He was eventually diagnosed with bipolar, and 3.5 years ago, we lost him to this illness, and it devastated my family. I love this picture. Jack was the proud dad to three children. Here he is with my niece, Sutton. She was 18 when her father died. Like many who've lost someone, I decided I wanted to make a difference in what I see is a broken approach to mental health in our country. I study movements, and like Jack, I like to interview people. So with a team of colleagues, we interviewed advocates, clinicians, people living with mental illness, others. What we heard was universal and overwhelming. Our system is broken. Rates of anxiety, depression, substance use, suicide were going up, made worse by the COVID-19 pandemic, a national reckoning on racism, and the climate crisis. But it wasn't all bad news. We met brilliant people pursuing innovative, promising solutions. You just heard from some. They know what needs to be done, but they don't have the power to do it. So we took lessons from the marriage equality movement, where I was lucky to work for over a decade, and set out to adapt some of those lessons for the mental health field. 18 months ago, we launched Inseparable around a pretty simple idea. The health of our minds can't be separated from the health of our bodies. Yet we allow our health system and our public policy process to separate them every day. We believe that we have the power to change that. We're focused on three big problems. The first is addressing the large number of people who need help but aren't getting it. This treatment gap impacts over 30 million people, and closing it means making care affordable, making sure people get what they pay for from their insurance, integrating mental health into primary care, and building a bigger workforce that looks and sounds like the people they serve. The second big problem is the mental health crisis with children all over our country. Things were bad before, and the pandemic made it worse. Too many kids are struggling, so we're focused on putting comprehensive school mental health systems in every school in our country through the Hopeful Futures campaign. The last big problem is what brings us all to Philadelphia today. mental illness is one of the only medical conditions that we routinely criminalize. Think about that. We all know it starts with a broken crisis response system that ends up putting far too many people into prison instead of into treatment and recovery. Nothing can make you feel more helpless than when someone you love is in crisis and you don't know what to do, who to call, or where to turn. For many, calling 911 is an act of total desperation. And for people of color, dialing 911 can turn crisis into tragedy, like it did for the family of Daniel Prude. Joe Prude's brother Daniel was having a crisis so severe Joe had to call 911. Police responded by handcuffing Mr. Prude, putting a spit hood over his head, and pushing his face into the pavement until he stopped breathing. He was resuscitated at the scene, but later died in the hospital. His death is a stain on our country. Our response to crisis starts with a phone call or a text. 988 is already live on your phones here today, and it launches nationwide in July. This thing is here, and we're not ready. Few communities have robust crisis systems attached to those call centers, which means law enforcement will continue to be the default in-person response for longer into the future than many care to acknowledge. Those in law enforcement know it's not working. Cities across the country are piloting co-responder models that pair law enforcement and mental health professionals. Others are building even more promising systems that don't involve police at all. But we're heading towards disaster if we don't talk about the giant elephant in the room, and it's this: you get what you pay for. Earlier this year, Senator Catherine Cortez Masto and Senator John Cornyn introduced a bipartisan bill that would help address this problem of how we pay for crisis. Their bill would require public and private insurance to cover crisis services and would create the first ever national standards for crisis care. And even though we can get wonky and clinical about this topic, we have to talk about the people that this law will help and the communities that it will enable to develop, expand, and sustain crisis response systems. We have to make it personal and talk about the care that every one of us would want for the people that we care about the most. We need to pass this law so we don't lose the future of crisis response before it even starts. So today, Inseparable is partnering with Fountain House and other mental health groups to launch a new campaign called A Better Response. Our goal is to build awareness and support for a better response to mental health crisis. We hope you'll join us by going to abetterresponse.us. For me, and I know for so many of you, getting this right is deeply personal. A few months ago, the little girl from one of the pictures I showed you, my niece Sutton, graduated from the same college I did. She has a lot more of those honor cords than either Jack or I did. She's now a student at Yale Divinity School and wants to spend her life in service of others. Sutton and the next generation give me hope. Hope can lead us to do remarkable things. It can help us to transform our broken systems so that we give people the life-saving care they need. It can help us put people on the road to happiness and fulfillment. But my friends, hope needs a push. It needs you, and it needs me, working together to build a movement that allows us to take better care of each other. Phone calls, letters, tweets, actions, and a united voice that show our movement means business and that we want a better response, because nobody's worst day should take away their chance to live their best lives. Thank you.
Wow, thank you to all of our PechaKucha presenters. I believe I now instruct you to come up and take a seat, and I will be turning it over to my friend and colleague Dan Gorenstein to do a Q&A. Before I do, gentle reminder to please download your app, your CVent app, enter into profiles where you will find surveys, and in there the PechaKucha survey. After Dan is done with his Q&A at approximately 4:55, I will come back up and share the results of your vote. Again, the criteria for the vote is the most innovative and scalable solution to decriminalize mental illness. Again, I just want to say on behalf of the entire foundation how grateful we are for your work. I want everyone to know that everyone here on this stage and the organizations that they represent have received $5,000 in Sozosei grant funds already for their participation here. So hopefully that will alleviate some pressure with voting. Dan, I turn it over to your expertise.
Thanks, Melissa. And let's just give a round of applause to these people who are doing some real good work, some important work, and also exhibited a lot of creativity, a lot of passion, a lot of love. So I took a lot of notes. I could ask an individual question to each of the presenters, but before digging into that, I think I'd really just like to open it up to everybody. And for folks, just so you know, you can take your masks off while you're on the stage if you want, whatever you want, but just let you know there. I think the question I have to anybody is, as you were putting this presentation together, did you learn something about your work? Did you get any insight into the work that you were doing that helps you better think about what you're going to do tomorrow because you put this presentation together?
Absolutely.
Please.
Putting this presentation together actually was not easy. But what it did do was allow me to grapple with real realities. Where are we with mass incarceration and mental health? And I rarely do presentations and include my mother. And that was an awakening for me. And what does it really look like when we remove mothers from communities? And how does my legislation really going to change that?
And real two questions. One, what did it mean on a personal level for you to include your mother in such a public way?
It was hard. But I said, you know what? We can't get healed if we don't hurt. And if nobody ever knows her story, they wouldn't even understand why I'm here. And so for that, it was worth it.
How do you think she'd feel about you including her story right now?
I think in this moment, she would be honored, because every tragedy that we've ever had, I'm going to make sure the world doesn't forget it. And it's going to be for our benefit.
And thank you for that. Thanks for letting us get a little personal there. In terms of this legislation, you mentioned that in your presentation. Can you share with the audience a little bit more what is this type of legislation that you are talking about pushing around?
It's a mass incarceration mental health bill, because post-traumatic stress disorder is for the military. That does not mean post-traumatic prison disorder. It's not the same benefits, and it's not the same coverage by any insurance in America. And so people coming out of prison only have access to Medicaid and Medicare, which only pay for psychotropic drugs and a psychiatrist. There's no alternative to medication in treatment. And that can't be the way we heal a country, is by giving you big pharma and new jail sentences, because that's all that is. And so for the first time, I'm asking that we really deal with mass incarceration and mental health in its totality. And we write legislation and we don't know what happens to it. And I'm asking for government oversight, that the Senate and the Assembly actually get a report back every year from the DOC. And they have to answer for the report. Because if you are not treating people, then you have to release them into a society or a program that can. We have obliterated mental health hospitals in this country. And prison is the new hospital. That's unacceptable. Prison is not a mental health is not a crime.
And what state are you starting?
New York and Michigan.
New York and Michigan. Excellent. Okay. Anybody else have any other insights? And thank you. Anybody else have any other insights as you were putting together your presentations that'll help, that's gonna help you do what you're doing better tomorrow for putting this presentation together?
I think we're all being shy here. I would say, honestly, the process of working with Sozosei was extremely helpful. I got a lot of really rich feedback from the team on, I believe in research. I believe in quality of care. I believe in serving our patients in ways that we're confident are actually going to help them. And research puts people to sleep. And it's a hard thing to convey in a passionate way. And so, I have to say, I feel quite some imposter syndrome sitting on the stage with these amazing people who are so impressive and inspiring. But like, I think part of the process is to say, this does matter. We gotta all push for these things that we all believe in so much and make that case in a compelling way with really clear communication.
And Matt, a follow-up for you based on your presentation. I was wondering, obviously you're talking about this whole research agenda, and there's so many different pieces of research, there's so many questions that you've posed, and there's such a paucity of data out there. I'm just curious to really just try to narrow it down to one thing. What's a question that you know our country will not be able to answer that we need to answer once 988 is up and running because that data doesn't exist?
No, that's a great.
Wow.
All right, narrow it down. For me, the thing that I see when I'm seeing people who are in crisis in clinical settings, when I'm going to connect with somebody who's really in crisis, is it's so hard. How do I help you? How do I actually contribute in the small way to helping your life be better so that tomorrow your life is somewhat closer aligned with your goals and what you want and what you can get out of it? And that so often the answer to that question is, what are you going to be able to access? What kind of services are you going to be able to access longer term beyond just our very brief interaction here today? Mm-hmm. And that's when I'm on a mobile crisis service. That's when I'm working in psych emergency and in any kind of setting. And true for 988 calls too. And understanding what happens post-crisis is an extremely complicated thing to try to capture because our data is just all over the place. To figure out what truly are post-crisis call, the follow-up linkage rates, what are post-crisis call incarceration rates, all of those pieces, those data are so all over the place that I think to really see, is 988 working? Is 988 actually helping the people that we're trying to serve connect to care? And care might not even be a goal of people who are in crisis, right? Like people might feel like, I don't want to talk to a psychiatrist or to a psychologist or anybody. I want to connect with my family again. I want to, take a break from work because I, just had a kid and I don't get family leave in this country. There are so many different types of experiences that can lead to quote unquote crisis that it's that nuance of are we actually helping people? That right now, I don't think that we could clearly answer that question beyond just saying we answered a bunch of calls.
And so, final thing here, when you talk about establishing a research agenda, it sounds like, at least based on this answer that you just gave, that a big part of, in your mind at least, setting that agenda is figuring out what happens after the crisis and pulling disparate folks together, all the silos, pulling folks from the different silos together to find a comprehensive way. That's one of the great research challenges.
Yeah, for sure. Exactly. I mean, the research agenda idea is there's a lot of experts in the field. There's a lot of work that has been done. We want to stand on those shoulders and, not start from scratch. But also we need to identify what are the main gaps and think about those gaps again in terms of how are we making sure that we're measuring and actually helping people? And importantly, in the research agenda piece, how are we including people who've experienced crisis themselves as part of that conversation to really make sure that we're actually measuring what matters?
Excellent, thanks. I know folks in the audience are gonna have questions, but I wanted be selfish a little bit more and ask you guys a couple more questions, because all the presentations were just so amazing, so interesting, so fascinating, and so inspiring and heartbreaking. At least that's how I found them. Anybody else have any insights, anything that they want to say about putting this presentation together, what you learned about the work that you do?
Yeah, I think for myself, working with Melissa and the team, it was just inspiring, I think, to take a step back. I tell my story so often. I tell the story of our work really often, probably more than what I need to. But I think in a very succinct manner, in 6 minutes, it's a lot of pressure in telling that story. And so I think it just, it's a beautiful challenge, because I think we also have to think about the way that people learn. And I think we're in a society that just moves really quick now with technology. And so it just really allowed me to, continue to lean into, being a lot more succinct with how we're delivering our, stories and the work that we're doing, and really meeting the audience needs. Because like I said, I really think we're learning much more quicker and more rapidly. And so I think they helped me out in that space a lot. So.
And Lorenzo, I'm glad you spoke up, because I had a couple questions for you too. Three, in fact. I won't ask them all, but I'm really curious. I think there are a lot of people in this room and around the country who believe in some version of the work that you are doing, which is we need to diversify our workforce. We need, and as you talked about, like bringing everyday people to the solution. And that really is a huge part of the solution. And so to that end, I'm really curious, because obviously you were having so much success here. I'm going to ask you about lessons learned. Since you all started, what have you learned about a better way to train the barbers? Like, you started off with one model of training those barbers, and I'm just wondering if that has shifted or evolved as you've gotten deeper and deeper into that work, because I think those lessons could be really helpful to other people who are also doing that same kind of work with the everyday people you're talking about.
Right. Yeah, we started off really grassroots. Like, the story I told was just going inside of barbershops telling that exact story. Raw, emotional, and connecting with people, like everyday people. But as you know, in an organization, you go from doing it that way to, well, now we got to fund the work, right? So we got to, so you got to attract resources. So now it's a blend of wanting to not water it down from the intensity that we bring, but also like involve Harvard in the work, right? That brings a very critical and analytical lens to speaking to people that really don't get that side of it. So it's kind of a messy middle, right? But like, we gotta have the data to inform how we move forward, how we continue to keep the work resourceful. Mm-hmm. So that's been a challenge. And so I think that's just I think we're just kind of taking that in stride. We're approaching it from just a more thoughtful way.
I'm going to interrupt you. Go ahead.
I think it's also doing more critical follow-up, because a lot of times we're going to barbershops where, the foot traffic is 30. Sometimes it can be 20 to 30 people in and out the door. I mean, it's people in there getting a haircut, the TV is on, it's children in there, and we're literally in an intervention, like, right there, right? And it's a lot going on, but it's a lot of people, believe it or not, they want to learn that way, because it's to their speed, right? It's like not taking it out of context, and so I noticed when we do bring in, fill out these surveys, and it's this kind of pushback, like, hold on, are we doing the Tuskegee thing? it's a lot of apprehension. So, those are just kind of learned things that we've had to recreate, like how we collect our data and approach everyday people, because again, a lot of them just don't get it. That's just not at their speed of how we're delivering it. So I think we had to try to find the best ways to deliver the messages and stuff.
Final follow-up here. So, I think part of what you were saying is that you find a certain level of receptiveness from these everyday people, from the bar, in your case, from the barbers. They want to do the work, they kind of get excited about it. But then when you try to bring in that more analytical piece, while you're trying to study it, while you're trying to refine your process, people can kind of like get a little spooked by it.
Yeah.
And so what is it that you all, and maybe you don't have the solution for that, but what is it you all are experimenting with to sort of calm those jitters?
So right now we actually just got a grant in the state of Georgia where we're going to be, you know, assuring that our model can become evidence-based over time. And so we're going to take a group of barbers that's like never went through the program, and then we'll take a group of barbers that's went through the program and try to see the feedback and the reaction. Most of the time when they've kind of went through the program is they kind of get it now. It's like, you know, it's kind of a, but the newer guys, that's normally where it's like, that's normally where a lot of the apprehension comes from. Once they've got into the movement, we've, you know, we do follow-ups like once a month, focus groups and stuff like this. So I think that's one way to kind of, we're looking at so.
Okay, very good. Anybody else have anything before we open this up to the audience here? I know they're here.
One thing about this process and being at the summit that was really eye-opening for me and probably V, was understanding just the different pieces of the problems we're working on. And it's a privilege to be with everyone on the stage because there is the resources and knowing who to contact. It's who picks up the phone, who answers the text messages. It's a place to go, and it's a place where they get follow-up. And so we see these different pieces, and it's so much easier to break it down into these smaller pieces and see what we're working on in parts of that puzzle. And so it was really eye-opening for me to be part of this process and see everyone on this stage and how we're trying to solve these little fragmentations in a bigger picture.
And Gabriella, it was really interesting listening to y'all's presentation and how you are making this push to make sure some people, you know, people with disabilities are some of the most invisible people in our society. And so I'm curious, as these 988 things are rolling out and whatnot, which organizations are you trying to connect to make sure that the work you're doing and this population is included?
Yeah, so we work in the 911 space, and so we are trying to connect 911 and 988 together because these are huge problems that there needs to be communication between those two groups. Secondly, we work with national deaf organizations, but not just on the national level, at the state and local level. So it's really important for us to bring in different perspectives on how we can make 911, 988, but in particular, just crises or mental health emergencies that don't need a law enforcement response, for them to feel safe and to feel that someone can help them in their time of need.
And are you all beginning to partner with behavioral health groups or mental health groups at all?
Yeah, so that's why we're here and having conversations with these groups. And what's been really great is we're on weekly 988 calls with amazing organizations, and they kind of give us the newsletter, the basic overview of what's going on, because there's so much going on that's rapidly happening right now, and it can be tough to keep up with that. But having those weekly calls and understanding what NAMI is doing, SAMHSA, Vibrant, and keeping track of that, I think has been a really great resource for us.
And one final thing here, and you might have had this in your presentation and I just missed it, if so, I apologize. But for the audience's benefit here, if there's one data point that you think that really captures the problem for people who are deaf around 911, what is that data point? What's the data point you'd like people to leave here remembering to try to help them think of those people who are otherwise invisible?
I want this audience to think about someone who doesn't have a voice and someone who can't hear. because a lot of our solutions that I see in society, like this, the Alexa speaker, Siri, it's all voice activated. And so I want us to think about ways where we notify people with disabilities beyond sound and beyond activation of voice.
Mm-hmm. Great, thank you. Okay, let's turn it to the audience. If we've got something from the virtual audience, but first, anybody here in the room want to come up?
I would like to.
He's right there.
So you can hear me, see me. First of all, I really want to tell you how moved I was and how wonderful your presentations were, how illuminating. I go to a lot of conferences and put on workshops, and this was really fabulous. So maybe you can join me in thanking them for really special work. So I want to ask a question, really, a research question, but I just want to make a brief comment that the word patient, I think, is we talked about language, and I think patient sometimes means the doctor and the patient. It's not a partnership as much. There's an authority and a person being helped. So we use the word people. We're serving people. Whenever possible, we try to use that word because of that. But my question really is around what's the data point? And I would say, can we ask each person somehow, maybe you know, what helped you, who helped you, and how, regardless of the model? And it could, you know, it could be a doctor who said patient, it could be a peer, it could be something about the intervention, but, you know, what really made a difference and how did it do that? So.
Was that a question for me?
Did you have that directed at any person in?
Well, I don't know. The researcher was the one that.
Yeah.
All right, Matt, it's on
you. I'll try. It's a great question. And I totally appreciate the language around patient versus client versus person, partner. You know, I thank you for that comment. So the answer is absolutely. So a couple different strategies for really including people themselves in the research process. So one is actually an example from San Francisco Department of Public Health. Right now we have a grant from the Robert Wood Johnson Foundation to evaluate our implementation of a new street crisis response team. It's a 911 dispatched co-responder model where a paramedic, a behavioral health clinician, and a peer specialist all respond to people who otherwise would have gotten a police response. So it's very much focused on diversion. It's very much focused on everything that we're talking about here today. And the grant, yes, we're looking at numbers, we're looking at health data, health records, you know, that kind of quantitative outcome data. But it's a mixed method study where we're also conducting qualitative interviews with people who've received services from the street crisis response team itself. And so conducting these interviews primarily with people who are experiencing homelessness, primarily with people who have a range of serious mental illness to substance use to or combination, they're formal ways of assessing those perspectives and really trying to integrate their ideas and what were obstacles, what were things that made it possible for them to get what they wanted in the moment of crisis and after, and to be able to describe that in a formal, rigorous way that can then contribute to other models. The other thing that I'll mention really briefly is there's a whole body of research, which I'm not an expert in, but it's called community-based participatory research or community-based participatory action research, which is another type of qualitative model where you're engaging people from the community that you're trying to create interventions for, and they help directly inform the intervention itself in a research-based way.
I just want to share a bias. I believe you'll find a person with lived experience or the same experience as the person. And it doesn't have to be a doctor, it could be in any of these models. And maybe it's self-evident, but I think so powerful. So if there's a way you can, sort of get at that too. Thank you.
Thank you. And before you ask your question, if you can also direct it to who you'd like to answer it, please.
Yes, my question is actually for Affect Mental Health and the Camden Medical Legal Partnership. I was interested to see how you guys saw the ability to grow outside your geographic locations and expand to a more nationwide and have a bigger impact.
I would say from thank you for the question. In terms of growth, I think, I guess I would look at it more as a question of scalability. I think that the medical legal partnership model is a model that can be implemented across the country without question. And I think the way that we've tried to do it, integrating that with care coordination services, is something that can work everywhere. We as an organization, we certainly try to capture the benefits of the work that we're doing. We try to educate others about that work. I don't think our view is to ourselves do that, but I think that the MLP model is really a good model for this kind of work, and certainly something that is that has popped up all around the country. There's been a growth of MLPs over the last decade and a half. They all look differently. They all work differently. And we're trying to advocate for this sort of approach where you're integrating with care teams and providing a whole host of social supports, including those legal services.
Mm-hmm. I would also say it's funny that you paired us with Affect, because I immediately thought when I was listening to their presentation, wow, it would be awesome to throw a lawyer on that team as well. I actually used to work on an ACT team prior to law school life, and adding that added benefit of just having an attorney that you can consult with about these random legal issues that pop up and help people tackle these really long old rap sheets of all of these offenses that they had racked up is really helpful. And so I think that there are lots of other opportunities for collaboration in the future, but also it is a really scalable model.
Yeah, I'll add that. I think about sustainability a lot, and it's especially disappointing that 988 is an unfunded mandate, and yet it's going to be one of the most one of the most transformative mental health, public health, intervention of our time. And so I've thought a lot about where the dollars are already being spent as a starting point. And so we've been very intentional in picking things that work, right? So we know ACT, they not only work, but they work really well, right? Like five-fold reduction in hospital days. That's a lot of money that you can then reinvest. Same thing with Housing First, right? 85% of people still housed after a year. And then how do we think about is it national? Is there already a credible financial foundation already, right? So assertive community treatment, thanks to a lot of advocacy by NAMI, everyone, it's a grassroots effort, is now for Medicaid reimbursed in over 40 states. And then same thing with Housing First, right? A lot of advocacy, and now Congress has deemed it as the solution to homelessness. And so we were very intentional in bringing those two models together because there's already foundational financial support, and there's an opportunity to bring them together and be synergistic. So 1 + 1 can be 3, right? And as I participate in this conference, I'm just so inspired because I feel like, the crisis system, unfortunately, is unfunded, right? But the people I really care deeply about, right, are, utilizing a lot of resources, right? And so the infrastructure I helped build for this population, I think very nicely can be used as a scaffold for a 988 crisis, right? So if you bring together the health, housing, and justice systems together, in a very focused way for this very, this population that is just suffering so much again and again and again, and you do that in a financially sustainable way, that can start to trickle down to anyone who touches the crisis system. So I don't know if that answers your question, but the models that we are trying to integrate are already national.
Thank you. And let's get this question from the virtual audience. Mm-hmm. I heard a lot of discussion about how to meet the needs of people with mental disabilities, all of y'all. If anybody wants to answer it. I heard a lot of discussion about how to meet the needs of people with mental health challenges, but did not hear much about how to include those people as active participants instead of only as recipients. How do you see your work evolving to allow more partnership with people with mental health needs?
Barbara. My answer. Well, I've spent a lot of time as a community-based social worker in my career, spent a lot of time in neighborhoods, spent a lot of time with people, And I have to say, being present with people, listening to people, and learning from them is so important. And people in the neighborhoods that I've met and I've worked with, I've learned more from them than they've ever taught, that I could ever teach them. So I think it's important for us to remember that we should never be making decisions for people without the people with lived experience at the table. Mm-hmm. And that is so important. And so, you know, I always challenge people, spend some time in your neighborhoods, in your communities. Spend some time with people that are being affected. Spend some time just hanging out at churches or hanging out at homeless shelters, hanging out at different places. And just learning about your community, hanging out at your neighborhood centers. You know, those are so important. And making sure that we're able to be not only that we hear people, but we can be the voice for people as we move forward with change.
And Barbara, on that point, is there a specific example, you know, that gorgeous photo you shared in your presentation of the college-like campus, so pretty. Mm-hmm. As you have built this center, how did what we all saw on that screen get input from these people who have mental health needs? Did they help design it? Did they help think about like what the treatment should look like? What was their involvement?
Yeah, the community was involved, and we have several task forces in our community, and we are very fortunate to have many people in recovery and family members as part of those task forces and coalitions. And we asked their opinion. We surveyed people in the community. We asked the neighborhoods around the community. And I'll tell you, just, you know, we were discussing about, one example is we were discussing the fence around the center, and we wanted to make sure it was still open to the neighborhoods and that people didn't feel like it was an institution. We had probably hours, I mean, I would say probably 8 to 10 hours of meetings over what the design of a fence should look like, because it was important to the community to know that this doesn't feel like an institution. It doesn't feel like it's a place that people can feel welcomed and people can feel hope in their healing.
Great, thank you. Yes, sir.
Michael Champion from Hawaii, thank you for all of your presentations. I feel, even though I've been working in this field for about 30 years, today is a very inspiring day just listening to you and the innovation that you bring. So thank you for that, number one. One of the themes that has emerged for me during this last 2 days is the importance of prevention, but not only upstream prevention from today moving forward. And why that's important is because folks who have been traumatized by the criminal justice system need to have that addressed and supported this day moving forward, mm-hmm. if we're going to reduce bad outcomes in the future. Mm-hmm. So this question goes out to the whole panel, but I'd be particularly interested in Ms. Vaughn, your response to this. And that is, could you help us understand from your perspectives why it is so important to address trauma when trying to accomplish decriminalizing mental illness, and in your projects that you're putting forward, for those of you who have that wrapped in, how have you wrapped it in?
How have you wrapped in trauma into your work?
And the importance of it in decriminalizing mental illness. Thank you.
I didn't wrap it into my work. I am my work. So literally, I'm a human experiment among 70 other million people. And so I think that if we are to take and to fix trauma, it has to be by people that are traumatized. And so I started with, first of all, healing myself. I've been in therapy 10 years, and I'm going to die in therapy. But I understand that therapy looks different for each individual. It's like an IEP for a kid that goes to school. So I sent in surveys to prisons, and I said, listen,
what was your childhood trauma? What did that look like? So I started with ACEs, and I said, okay, well, how did you get to prison? And I realized that everybody was traumatized 7 to 9 times before they ever got to prison. So trauma got them to prison. And when they got to prison, prison is its own trauma. For me, I learned that there's more sexual assault and trauma than there was that I ever learned when I was free, because I went to prison at 17. And so I start to ask the question, and I understand that to heal trauma, first of all, you have to be somebody that was traumatized, because you know what your healing looks like. And it's not textbook. And so it's a holistic lens, and it looks different. And it's an individualized service plan. And that's what I'm shooting for, that people who are children of incarcerated parents, that they get their own survey so they don't become incarcerated. And the people that are already incarcerated, that they get individualized service plans, because guess what? Everybody doesn't need medicine. Everybody doesn't need a textbook therapist, because therapy has to look like you. And so I believe it needs an individualized service plan. And that's what I'm lobbying for today and forward, you know, that we actually include everybody in the healing.
Excuse me. Wow. Sorry. Not COVID. just some spit. We have like 2 minutes. Bill, you haven't had a chance to say anything yet, and so I've got a question for you. You have got this campaign that you've just launched today, and I think the question really is, like, what is this campaign? What are you campaigning for?
So the goal is for us to pass the Behavioral Health Services Crisis Expansion Act. Not a very sexy title, but it's an important bipartisan bill that would change the way we finance so much of this by requiring insurance to cover crisis services, and would for the first time allow the Department of Health and Human Services to define what crisis services are. While we have an HHS secretary that I would say is very friendly to this community, so it's a chance for us to get a robust definition of crisis. But the purpose of the campaign is to bring people into this conversation, because as much good work as has been done on 988, we're not ready, and we've got to get the financing structure of this right in order to for the system to work.
And is this piece of legislation really, in your mind, a linchpin? You think if this legislation passes, things will be different?
It's a fundamental shift in how we deal with the financing of crisis, and it's also sort of a backdoor towards parity. Because when, for the first time, you have a piece of legislation that says whether you get your insurance through an Affordable Care Act plan or through TRICARE if you're in the military, or Medicaid or Medicare, all of those things have to pay the same way for crisis. And that's a revolutionary concept. It's a little sad, frankly, that is a revolutionary concept. But that's what we think's at stake, and we think it's important that we bring the community together, engage in a campaign, and pass this legislation.
And the final question here, I'm sure people in the room are curious, what's the state of this legislation right now? I believe it's in the Senate. What are its prospects?
So there is a bill introduced in the Senate, and there's also one in the House. Both bills are bipartisan in nature. I consider myself sort of a good lefty, and I have to tell you, when I saw that Senator John Cornyn was one of the people who introduced this, it made me do a double take. But it also was inspiring to me to see that no matter where you are on the political spectrum, people see that what we're doing is not working, and that we have to dramatically change this. And so with a bill in both chambers right now, they have to hear from us. There's kind of a cycle where people say, well, some of these changes are hard, so let's not talk about that. And people on the Hill say, well, I haven't heard anybody talk about that. So it's never been more important for us as a movement to make our voices heard. One of the things we included in the campaign is a tool, a click-to-call tool that anyone can use. It's not about inseparable. It's for the entire movement to be able to call their member of Congress, call their senator. A script pops up on your screen to even tell you what to say, and that's a tool that we want to give to every single organization that cares about mental health. A tool, frankly, we were able to build with the help of the Sozosei Foundation, But we think that's the key to this, is that people have got to hear from us and we've got to raise our voice on it.
Absolutely. Very good. Melissa, I think it is your time. One last round of applause for this incredible group. Thanks, y'all.
Very trusting. Dan, I also really want to thank you and give a very special shout out to my favorite healthcare policy podcast, which is Tradeoffs. That Dan and Sozosei is so very honored to be supporting Dan in his work as he works on a 988, a couple of episodes about 988. That's coming up, and I know everyone will be generous with their time if Dan calls to interview them. I think he displayed for us that he's a fair and good interviewer. So thank you, Dan, for your contributions through Tradeoffs. I'd like to give everybody just 30 seconds more to sort of close the vote and just offer some reflections on this experience with all of you today. First, hearing gratitude about working with us means so very much. And I want you to know that we are so very grateful to be working in community with all of you. That Sozosei as a foundation, you know, philanthropic entities are often looked at things that give out. And what we try to do through the summit and through our processes is to take in, that we are deeply invested in our own culture of curiosity and learning. And we take in. And as Dr. Carson said earlier, we also view ourselves as a clearinghouse of information. And so I hope that everyone here, our wonderful presenters, everyone in the audience at home, at work, and here today in Philadelphia, feel that they can constantly share with us and that we're very open for that. And now please, let's all practice exercising our very important and sometimes eroding right to vote. Shameless plug for democracy there for just a few more moments. But again, really so grateful. A little housekeeping, because I'm getting so good at the housekeeping. Tonight for dinner, we are here at PAFA, as we call it affectionately, but we're not in this modern building. We're next door in the historic space. Give yourself time to really explore that building. It is incredible. We'll have wonderful food, live music, and of course, one another's company for those who are here. Virtual friends, we are missing you deeply. And with that, I'm just gonna step over here to, it's like the auditor, right? to let us know what our results are. Please excuse me, auditor.
30 seconds.
Oh, auditor is requesting 30 seconds. Like, you know, if you were a child in the 70s, whatever that ball was that happened. Everybody's feeling good, good. Democracy at work. Again, please remember that. You know, that was an interesting additional reflection about District Attorney Krasner, is that voting down ballot for your prosecutors and your sheriff's offices can have a huge impact on the decriminalization of mental illness, since I'm riffing on democracy as I stand over poor Berkeley. No pressure, Berkeley. Okay, thank you. Now I use my glasses and take them off. Wonderful. Again, with recognition that everyone on the stage is a Sozosei grantee, I'm really just pleased to tell everyone that the Confess Project led by Lorenzo Lewis has received an additional $25,000. Thank you, Lorenzo. And let's give all of our PechaKucha presenters one more round of applause. And again, so honored to be in community with all of you, and especially all of you. I'll see you all tonight at dinner in the historic building. Enjoy your break. Thank you, guys.
Chiquitita, tell me what's wrong. You're in shame by your own sorrow.